grateful for the opportunity to talk to you folks. I wish I had that 5 hours tonight because I could surely use it. I want to tell you a lot. I'll be introducing you folks to a proven, sustainable method of gardening, the fit lighter system. Probably many of you heard of that. Is that something that's not new? Few of you heard of it, not too many. Did any of you see what was going on at Thanksgiving Point 15 years ago, when there was a great vegetable garden there? That was the Met Lighter Garden. And it was there for about 3 years until Alan Ashton took it down and moved it for the big dinosaur exhibit that I helped on that project. I'll tell you just a little bit about myself, then I'll show you some great gardens. I will then introduce you to Dr. Jacob Mittleider and take maybe 10 minutes to try and recap for you the 50 years of this man's unique contribution to the church and the world economy. He was, by the way, a Seventh-day Adventist. And he looked for many, many years to find someone to replace him in the Adventist church. And in the United States, I was the closest thing he could come. So he finally turned it over to a Mormon. This system of growing, folks, is so simple that an 8-year-old can quickly read a little book and put it in a garden and have a great garden. I know that because when I first got introduced to it, that's what we did. My youngest daughter was 8 years old, and she helped me with the garden, and once we got it installed and planted, she ran the garden for the year. The system of growing is so comprehensive, folks, that it constitutes a college education in agronomy. We taught it for the entire day for 4 months on the Pupillon Columbia campus, their agriculture campus, and when we finished, 5 of our best students were immediately hired to teach agronomy in the high schools in that city. So it goes all the way from simple, that a child can do it, to a equivalent of college education. See the little lady down in the back there? She was about 8 years old at that time. And this is her family's backyard garden. Small garden. Wasn't really big. But they not only ate out of that garden, but they and many of their neighbors did as well. And that's what you can do in the dirt. So there's really little by way of limits to what you can do with this system of growing. What does it take for you to do it? You can jump in at any level. Beginner, advanced, anywhere in between, and enjoy great gardening success simply by following this recipe. And I say that advisedly, because it really is accurate and complete. And the closer you follow the recipe, the greater your success will be. I've been a Mittleider grower for about 38 years. I worked personally with Dr. Mittleider for most of that time, as David said. And for the last 15 years, I've devoted my full-time efforts to taking this knowledge through the Food for Everyone Foundation. It's a 501c3, similar to a church organization. As I mentioned, when I was in Pobian, Colombia, one of the professors wanted to do an experiment. As I was talking about the fertilizing regimen we use, he was a little skeptical, to say the least, and he wanted to find out how what we were teaching compared to what they were teaching at the university there. And they had two different kinds of fertilizers that what they were using, and I won't bother to tell you what they are, but he then set up a comparison with his students using mycelium that we had grown in our greenhouse, and then I gave them our fertilizer, and they used the two different fertilizers that they used. It was a couple of weeks before the changes were evident, and by this time, which is about 4 or 5 weeks, he begged me to end the experiment and start feeding his plants. So that's the kind of thing that we have seen in many places. This is my garden when I was living in Alabama just 3 years ago. We just moved to Missouri. It'll be 3 years in July. So this would have been about 3 years ago garden. This is what I promise people, great garden in any soil with no soil amendments. This is the kind of garden that we see many times when we go places around the world. We saw this kind of garden in Colombia. This actual garden here is another location Jacob and I went to. But this is what can be made off that when you get rid of the weeds and the diseases and then feed properly. Those three things, eliminate weeds, diseases, give the proper nutrition, and obviously water. This is, of course, what the result was. I'll mention this again later. Same location. This is what they were growing using the best organic methods that they could, producing 1.5 tons per acre in 22 months. And this is what was done in 10 months, producing 15 tons per acre on the same ground in the same location. What was the difference? No weeds, no diseases, proper nutrition. What kind of conditions do you have to grow a great garden? This is Santa Clara, California, or Santa Clara, Utah, next to St. George. And this was below sand. Our friends who heard about this method when we were visiting with them one time said, well, we want to grow a garden on our property outside of town. And they announced it to their neighbors, and they were about laughed out of town. That is the kind of garden that you can grow even in low sand, if you do those things correctly. Now notice, the soil isn't providing very much by way of nutrition or anything. And that's kind of the way it is in many locations around the world. Not necessarily low sand, but nutrition is very deficient. So what's your challenge here? If you can protect against the elements and do these other things, you can have gardens like this. This is the lady who grew in that low sand. And this was the first real garden they'd ever been able to produce. This is one day's harvest out of the low sand garden. Now this lady, before she was introduced to this system of growing, knew nothing about gardening. She now is an expert. And people come from throughout the region to get seedlings, and fertilizer advice from this lady. I want to tell you a little bit about this man so that you can appreciate the extent of what he has done. 10 books and 9 manuals on gardening. They all have been digitized. They all are available. Developed and marketed a scientifically balanced natural mineral fertilizer formula that's available, that anyone can copy, that you can get and make yourself. It's not a secret. The reality is that stores don't sell it, and so a small family gardener has a difficult time getting it because they can't get the micronutrients in the stores. Because of that, we have made those available to the world. This is where he came from. Started in Idaho. Hated farming, as he was forced to do as a boy, and he decided to be a baker. He became a really good baker and learned those lessons well. But he had a hot temper, and one day he threw his apron off and walked out. And so he had to fall back on being a grower, because that's all the other thing that he knew. And he had a wife and 2 kids. So he created what's called Mint's Nursery. This is in Loma Linda, California, east of Los Angeles. And over the course of 19 years, he earned 11 plant patents. He earned a lot of money. He became so well known, so highly regarded, that he was shipping his plants all the way into Louisiana, through Arizona, New Mexico, Texas. Clear back in those days, it was a big deal to be doing long-haul trekking. He about lost his life. He had his stomach exploded, his son died, and he had a conversation with his Lord, promised to change and do something more productive. for this life. He was 43 at that time. And turns out the Lord gave him another 43 years in which he changed the world. He took his money and visited 24 countries over the course of 6 months. He came back to the Loma Linda University, folks. That's an Adventist school, if you don't know. And he said to them, there's no reason why people should be dying of starvation in this world. Or God in worship would not create an earth who wouldn't support its people. And after he'd made that 6 month tour, he said, it's true. They've got land, they've got sun, they've got water, and they waste all three. So they said, well, put your money where your mouth is. Are you ready to go do something about it? Because what he discovered was everywhere he went, they had hospitals and they had facilities to try and help the people, but they had nothing to create better nutrition, better food. And he knew that he could do something about that. And so this is where he went. For over 3 years, he and his wife lived among these people in one of the scariest places on earth. These people were cannibals until the Australian military came in and stopped them at the point of a gun. And many times these folks in many of these villages, they were dying of a terrible disease called the Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. And the reason was because they had the winners and the losers. And anyone know that disease by a different name? It's called mad cow disease, yes. And this is about Jacob a very important lesson, that animal byproducts have some risk involved. Just a few years ago, the entire world quarantined the Great Britain beef and meat industry because of the mad cow disease. And in this country, here in America, we have been turning our animals into cannibals as well by feeding old and sick cows to the next generation of cows. Okay, so this is what he started in the Republic of Guinea. They had this situation with disease and malnutrition, weeds everywhere, and they were about to close the school and hospital down because they couldn't feed the staff, the little students. Jacob came in and immediately turned it into that. He used the row spacing, traditional row spacing, growing on ridges, the way the tractor farmers did, and still do. And he changed the yields of those people from 1.5 tons per acre in 22 months to 15 tons per acre in 10 months. And more than 20-to-1 increase. He changed the economy of that island nation in a big way. Back then there weren't any Adventists or Christians probably to speak of on that island. Today more than 10% of the island is Adventist. 25% of their parliament are Adventists. The boy here, his name's Silas, he was Jacob's yard boy. He's now known as His Excellency, Sir Silas out of poverty. President, Governor General of Papua New Guinea. These are the kind of things that Jacob did several places around the world. The school became highly profitable and is highly profitable today. And frankly, the ODS missionaries have told me the Adventists own Papua New Guinea. This is what he did in Africa. 4 countries in Africa he made these changes. This is Kenneth and his garden before he attended the Midlighter School. Of course, you see greatly malnourished crops. He was pretty good at keeping the weeds down, but the crops didn't amount to much. And that's what happened to his garden immediately after he graduated from Midlighter School there. Oh, by the way, let me just take a minute. Notice the changes in the format. He's growing vertically, his tomatoes. He's growing in a 5-foot-wide solid bed there. That's probably 30 feet long. That was the length that he liked because it was easy to walk around, fairly easy to water. But massive amounts of food he was producing. Kenneth, before this class, would see $20 a year in cash. After the last 6 months, he had sold $575 cash crop, and he was still in the middle of his growing season. Over the next year, he was teaching 80 other farmers to do the same thing. Jacob would have changed the economy of Zimbabwe had not their government messed everything up by taking the land away from the cane growers and then destroying their currency. And you all probably know something about that. Very quickly, another island nation called Trinidad. The farmers were leaving their farms and going to the cities because of this terrible caliche soil that had no nutrition in it. And Jacob very quickly changed it to look like that. You saw that picture earlier. This applies a little bit to folks here because now he's growing using tea frames. A large, strong tea frame, much better than what you saw in Africa, wasn't it? Also has covering on it with large PVC. In that country, that would protect the plants from the sun and driving torrential rains. What would it do for us here in Mapleton? It can protect against cold. All you do is put that plastic down all the way and maybe put a little heat in it. This is one of the great things that he did for that country. Today, there are hundreds of successful wire growers on that island, and they export their food into South America and all the way north into Miami. I've been told by the biggest grower on the island, the only growers making any money are the other growers. So that's the kind of success that he created as he changed the economy in that country. Third place, and by the way, there are 27 countries, so we can spend the night just reviewing some of the things he did. I'll just give you the highlights of the report very quickly. This is Naha Okinawa. These people have no ground. They have driveways, flat roofs, patios. Jacob very quickly said, well, you can take care of that. Just go on your driveway. This is a cement or blacktop parking lot. And he was honored by the governments of Japan or Okinawa for changing the economy of that great country. In a big way. The last story I'll tell you will only take 3 or 4 minutes, if you'll bear with me. I think this one is very important. In early 1989, the Adventist Church wanted to open a little divinity college over in Russia. And amazingly, Mr. Gorbachev allowed that to happen. I guess on the proviso that they would allow, that they would provide an agriculture program. And so in their benevolence, they gave him a nice little dacha. That's what it looked like. It was underwater, and it was all weeds and bushes and trees. It didn't bother him. He just made a French drain right there, drained the whole thing, removed weeds and everything else, and very quickly turned it into this. Prior to his arrival, the people there, the 73 degrees north latitude, they never even seen crops like this. What do we got? We got zucchini and beans. They grew cabbage, carrots, potatoes, what was the other one? Beets. 18 crops. Things they'd never even thought could grow in Russia before. When they first saw this, those agriculture guys from the USSR, they were communists, and they started steaming his plants. And they would take them in their jacket, take them back to their labs, and try to test them, because they were just sure there was nitrate toxicity, that he was putting too much chemicals in his garden. After a few weeks, they finally came back to him and said, you got to tell us what you're doing. We can find no nitrate toxicity in any of these plants. What are you doing? He had the opportunity then to teach them. And they would start sending their graduate students from their five-year university to his three-month class. And we would hear the students, as they graduate, say, I learned more about growing food in 3 months than I did in 5 years at the university. The agriculture minister of the USSR went on national television and said, the only food grown in Russia that's fit to eat is grown in a red layer garden. They made him the featured speaker at the Yalta Conference of Agriculture Ministers. They honored him from the Timorosi Academy. And when his students graduated from this college, would go to their homes, they wouldn't have 200 or 300 people like we've got here, which, by the way, is a great crowd. You folks are very active, and I'm obviously preaching to the choir here, because you are highly involved in preparation, preparing to send them down Lady Gardy. Over there, they get 1,500 to 2,500 to a seminar. That's the kind of interest they have. Now, think with me for a minute, why this happened February of 1989? What was it that happened in August of 1991? And what had been happening in that country for the previous 50 or 70 years? A guy by the name of Joseph Stalin had murdered 13 million of his own people. He had collectivized the farms, put the people into factories, and destroyed their agriculture economy to the point they had even more food. These people no longer knew how to feed themselves. The communism was taken care of. They had the cabbage and the beets and the carrots that they needed to stay alive. They also had a measure of security. And when communism fell, many of them were frightened to death of the responsibility of freedom. But there were enough students out there throughout the regions of these countries that knew, and they had enough publicity, that they were, we would see them in the trains reading these little books that were translated into Russian, and they would be on their way from their downtown apartment to their dacha in the country, growing their own food once again. God did one other thing to prepare that country for the fall of communism. The end of June 1991, he sent his choir to Russia. I had the great privilege to be singing in the Tabernacle Choir at that time. And we went over there in Moscow and in St. Petersburg, and we sang about the God, the fatherhood of God, the brotherhood of man, the reality of the Savior Jesus Christ, in their own language. And amazingly again, Mr. Gorbachev allowed, not only allowed, but I guess encouraged, those concerts to be heard by his people, because several times, between the end of June and the middle of August, our concerts were played on their national televisions. You think that gave them an important spiritual boost? A little bit of a feeling, so that when their authorities told the soldiers, you shoot those people that were rebelling against communism, the soldiers refused to do it. Do you think Jacob, that letter changed the course of history in Russia? I believe he did. Today, it is the most popular and productive method of growing in many regions of the Commonwealth countries. I know because I'm correspondent with some of those students. So, this is what I did in Madagascar. I came from the OKS Church. We established a school there, and our students became teachers and newspaper people and college professors, and obviously commercial growers. I was very blessed for that opportunity. The same thing happened in Popayan, Colombia, as I mentioned. This is probably the reason you all are here. Back in 1978, Spencer W. Kimball said every family should have a garden. And he followed it up by saying, grow all the food you can on your own property. Grow vegetables and eat those grown in your own yard. Even those residing in apartments or condos can generally grow a little food in pots and planters. So, I want to teach you the six laws of plant growth. And I'm probably preaching to the choir again. How many of you are farmers? How many of you have gardens? Please forgive me. Most people who see and hear this don't understand this all that well. And so we'll go through it and hopefully go glean a little something from it. I think that it's very important. It turns out that this is the basis for the great success of this system of growing worldwide. It's sometimes called the poor man's hydroponic method of growing. The hydroponic methods do it best in terms of volume, because a successful hydroponic grower can produce 330 tons of tomatoes in 1 acre. 330 tons. A tractor grower can produce about 30 to 35 tons an acre. I said, 10 times, isn't it? And the typical backyard gardener, if they were to extrapolate their yield into a 1 acre, probably would be 10 to 15 times. And sometimes even less. The mid-layer system of growing can do far, far better than either the tractor grower or the typical home gardener. See, the problem with a hydroponic grower, it takes $1 million plus per acre just for his investment. That's not quite within our reach, is it? But we can approach those yields. In Utah, you can approach 100 tons of tomatoes 1 acre using this system of growing. A little bit more than typical backyard gardening, isn't it? And yet we can do it at that level of competency in the smallest space. And we'll change it. 6 feet, 10 feet, 20 feet. We can grow tremendous amounts in that kind of space. We're sometimes also called the best of organic method also. And hopefully the Tobinites at all at least give you a glimpse into the reason for that. You'll have to hurry to get to it. But you can have a great garden in any soil and in virtually any climate without any soil amendments. Just remember these six laws of plant growth, if you will. Light is the first. 95% of the plant is the result of photosynthesis. And that, of course, is done using the three elements the plants get from the air. Carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen. From which they create carbohydrates. A lot of people don't even know what that funny name comes from, but that's where it comes from. Because of that, the plants need full sunlight all day long. Now, you've got to avoid shade. You don't want to have that shade coming from a house, a tree, a fence, or how about other plants? I've got, by the way, this is my garden at Utah's Hogle Zoo. Did anybody ever see the big garden next to the giraffes in Utah's Hogle Zoo? That was my garden for almost 20 years. And this particular year, I wasn't paying too much attention to this particular lot of plant growth because I had my tomatoes to the east, my corn to the west, and my sweet peppers in the middle. It was 10:30 in the morning. What was just beginning to happen for my peppers? Just getting sunlight, weren't they? And by 3 in the afternoon, they were in the shade again. So my peppers didn't do well until I cut down my corn. And they got full afternoon sun. The key then is to plant tall plants to the north or east of short plants. A lot of people say, well, you've got to have your rows north and south, or you've got to have this or that. The only thing that matters is plant tall plants north or east of short plants. Another thing about light, sometimes the plant will shade itself too much. Often this is the case, especially with things like tomatoes. So what you have to do then is remove some of those sucker stems, remove maybe excess leaves that are crowding other plants, and if you put it into cages, you actually are inhibiting the plant's ability to spread out and your ability to do that all-important pruning. And you make the light problems worse for the plant. Second law of plant growth, temperature. Notice we've got a greenhouse here. This is a greenhouse that we made, and it's primarily used for growing seedlings. That's why I used that example. Because seeds require a very narrow temperature range between 70 and 85 for most vegetable seeds. And they'll germinate very quickly if you'll keep the soil temperature at that range. If you get much below that, they won't want to germinate, and sometimes they will even rot in the ground. Other ways to mitigate the extremes of temperature, you can actually do it. Of course, in a greenhouse, you'll see seedlings growing in there. This, by the way, is Jacob and Lighter's backyard garden in Salt Lake City, Utah. He moved there because so many Mormons had him teaching them and helping them. And he moved about a mile from me, and that's why I had the great blessing of becoming his student. You'll see what he's got here is what we call mini greenhouses. Some people would call this a low tunnel. But that's another way of protecting your plants. We will show you that in the garden, in our seminars, and actually show you, teach you how to create those and how to use them. Either a greenhouse or a mini greenhouse. Of course, as it gets warmer, then you take those off, or if it's still quite cool, you'll just open the ends. Now, this actually can extend your growing season here in Mapleton 4 to 6 weeks in the spring. And it can also extend it in the fall by covering your plants this way. Or you might consider going year-round. I have created a year-round greenhouse, and notice the black pipe just sticking up there while I was behind the wall, but the post there, there are six black pipes sticking up. That is flush corrugated drain pipe, solid drain pipe. I've got that going back and forth underground. Each of those lines represents 110 feet. This 18 by 36 greenhouse is year-round, and I hope to be able to show you a couple of things. How would you like to be able to grow tomatoes, peppers, through the winter? This is not very expensive. This is not the kind of thing that they do with houses where they have to have heat pumps and the expensive installations. All I did was look at ditch rich and dug my trenches, put the pipe in, covered it up, put two layers on my walls for some insulation, and I have a year-round greenhouse. And guess what? I have citrus trees in this greenhouse right now. And by the way, it snowed today in Missouri. And as David said, my tomatoes are probably almost knee-high, and we've been eating greens for weeks and weeks and a couple of months. So, cold or heat, this one, as I told you, was, of course, protecting against heat. Third law of plant growth, air. Plants need that carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen, and they get it from the air. And so they have to be able to breathe at the root level. If you have standing water, you're going to smother those plants and kill them. The only thing we had to do was drain this field, and it became a great garden. Another thing that we do in this system of growing that avoids that problem is we raise the soil beds. You see these pepper plants here? They are actually below the ridge, not on the ridge, but at the base of the ridges, and that area is 1.5 or 2 inches higher than the aisles. You saw the picture at the very beginning of my wife with the zucchini plants. In that area, it rained almost every day for over 3 months, and sometimes it was 2 or 3 inches a day. I thought I was going to lose my plants to the river. But just this simple expedient right there of creating a bed like that, and then we would open the ends, the torrential rains would come down, the water would just seep out, and we never lost the plant to too much water. So this is a very important feature of this system of growing, and I hope as you folks look into it more, you will discover the tremendous benefits, a little bit of extra work it takes to do this. The beauty of it, though, is that once you make those beds, you never have to do anything with the aisles. I never had to till the aisles. I didn't even have to weed them very much because there was no water. I only applied the water to the root zone. Speaking of water, number 4 law of plant growth. And water has to be clean, but it doesn't have to be potable to humans. It just cannot be toxic, obviously. Remember that a plant is a continuous water pipe from the tip of the smallest root to the top of the highest leaf. It's 80% water. Because of that, it needs to have water at the root zone, at least moisture. It doesn't need to be flooding, it doesn't need to be soaking wet. But you've got to have moisture at the root zone continuously. If you don't, what does the plant do? It sends its roots deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. Here in the West, of course, when we are accustomed to irrigation maybe every 8 days. We grow plants with huge root systems, don't we? That's how they survive. Dr. Nutmegger wanted his plants to put their energy and resources into above ground growth, productive fruit. And so we water daily or as often as needed to keep the soil moist. We level our beds. This is also very important, so we don't waste the water. This again is the zoo garden. And what that does, it allows uniform distribution of water, natural mineral nutrients, water only the roots or the plants. I don't know how I got that messed up. We don't sprinkle. We want to conserve the water all we can. Not only does it waste water, but it waters the weeds and it encourages diseases. We make the rich beds, obviously, so that they define the bed and also conserve and contain the water and the fertilizers, so that we don't waste any of those things. We like to automate the watering system, and this is a simple, easy, highly effective, and highly productive or water-saving method of watering. My grandson's there blanket as well. So it's easier, it's faster, it's more efficient. We could spend a lot of time on that. We will show you in the garden, those of you who manage to come to our seminars. And of course, it's in the books. Pretty much everything I tell you tonight is available in a great book. It's called The Midlighter Gardening Course. It is a collaboration between some BYU professors of educational psychology and technology and Dr. Jacob Midlighter. In my view, the best gardening book on the planet. Just about the only one you need to have. Food is the fifth law of plant growth, so important, and so few people understand it. For example, in addition to those three that plants get automatically from the air, they need 13 other nutrients. Most of us know the top, the big three, the primary or major elements, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and we even apply those to our gardens many times. But how many of us are aware of and apply the secondary nutrients? There are calcium, sulfur, and magnesium. Any of you know those and use those in your garden on a regular basis? Not so many, and yet the plants need them. They are every bit as essential, just not in the same quantities. And then there are the cell trace elements that are also so important. Zinc, boron, manganese, iron, copper. Chloride and molybdenum. How many of you apply molybdenum to your garden? Not many. And yet these micronutrients make a huge difference in the growth, development of your plants. You know, so many gardens that you'll see look good, look okay, but they're not growing fast. They grow rather slowly, and they are actually suffering from something called hidden hunger. And that is because they lack most of these nutrients in some degree. And so when we look at gardens, we see something that has been there 5 months but it still hasn't produced. What could be wrong? We just understand that that is hidden hunger. Huge, huge difference in the growth of your plants. So we use something called natural minerals, mostly ground up rocks. Understand that they use these as water-soluble minerals through their roots. That means that because we apply all 13 that the plant needs in just the right amounts, right percentages, right quantities, there's no guesswork. We don't leave anything to chance. Remember, Jacob was a baker, and he followed a recipe. He didn't make any changes unless it was an improvement. He documented everything he did over the years. So, why is it so important that plants receive when we understand about this water-soluble minerals through the roots? Because if you're already giving them just exactly what they need as water-soluble minerals, there's no waiting. We don't need to wait for the red worms and the soil bacteria and microbes to digest organic material in the soil and turn it back into water-soluble manure. It's big. You see, when you're growing slow things like trees and shrubs, they can wait for those natural processes to take place. But if you want to produce vegetables for their entire life cycle, it's 50 to 100 days, we need that nutrition right now. And this is what we discovered, and this is what we have perfected, if you will, the feeding of the plants as they need it. And it's that continuous supply that is also extremely important. You see, just as an example, the certified organic grower must apply the organic materials, the manure and compost, between 90 and 120 days before harvest. The reason for that, of course, is that there's some danger of disease, infection, or whatever, from the manure. That means that they have to put it all down at the beginning. And what that does is it causes the potential for leaching of that oversupply of nutrients. And it also then has the potential to burn new seedlings when they're starting out. Let me tell you just a little quick story. When I had this zoo garden, people would ask if I use the animal manures. And I said, no, I've got something better we like. It's called Red Layer Magic. Oh, you need to use the animal manures. And one day somebody came and said, you need to use the manures. Yeah, the Seattle Zoo is using them, and they make a lot of money. They call it Zoodoo. That really got my attention, so I called the Seattle Zoo and found out what they were doing. And I discovered that they were taking their animal manures, the herbivores only, not the carnivores, and they were taking it out in the forest and they were piling it up and then windrowing it. And they leave it there for about a year, and then they bring it back in and dry it and pack it and stuff the suit. Now, everyone knows what it does in Seattle almost every day. It rains, doesn't it? And what does rain do to things that are laying out? It leaches the nutrients out of the dustbin. I'd like to do better than that. So I bought a compost tumbler. And I learned how to make the world's best compost. My compost came from 7 herbivores that healthy diets. And I put it in there and I balanced the carbon and the moisture and the nitrogen. And I got it to where it very quickly grew to 140 degrees plus. And I hold that because I'm trying to keep the oxygen in it. Easy for you to say. And within 3 weeks, I had beautiful black sweet smelling compost. The best ever. Problem was, my garden had 125 30-foot beds. And one of these compost tumblers would make a little pile that would maybe feed a third or a fourth of one bed. Well, this is nice, but it's not doing much good. So I went out and acquired a full-size cement truck. I had 12 yards, and I had the keepers bringing me the stuff. My wife was hating life whenever I came around. But for 2 years, I did this, and it took 4 weeks for that process, and then I had 5 or 6 yards of beautiful black-smelling compost. I bought the license, I got the equipment, the t-shirts, the bags, everything. We sold it in the zoo gift shop, we sold it in the nurseries. TV people came up and interviewed me, and the newspapers came up, and I became known as the Zoodoo Man. When I had more than I could sell, I would take my truck out of the garden, backload it, and I would put 2 or 3 inches in a bed, till it in, and grow. What did I learn over the course of 2 growing seasons? That I could grow a better garden more consistently for a fraction of the time, cost, hassle, smell, with the natural mineral nutrients that I could with the world's best compost. So, I learned a very important lesson in a very comprehensive way that I really hadn't thought I would ever have to learn. But I'm grateful that I did, because I believe that this system of growing is really the best of organic. Why? Because those same certified organic growers, when they see nutrient deficiencies in their crops, they are, in fact, allowed, and they do, use the same minerals that are in that bag. Now, they have to have a soil test first, and they have to prove the deficiencies, and they have to put in what is needed. But Dr. Midwinter went all over the world and felt like the small family grower had neither the time nor the money nor the expertise to do all of that. And because everywhere he went, he discovered deficiencies, he said, let's give them what they need, when they need it, and as they need it. And instead of putting, as I did in my zoo garden, 200 to 250 pounds of compost in a single bed, which includes about 10 to 15 pounds of salt, and I'm talking about the various fertilizer salts, it only includes maybe 1% of nitrogen and 1% of potash and so forth and so on, but about 5 or 6% total salts, you see. Well, 250 pounds times 5 pounds, 12 pounds, 12 and a half pounds of salt. But the manure grower is putting in that single bed. The bed binder grower is putting 7 ounces of salts in the bed at the same time. And those are balanced, and they're exactly what the plants need. Isn't that exciting? And we're doing it on several occasions, 3 or 4, 5 or 6 times throughout the growing season for that plant. Just when it needs it. And then we stop when it has enough. And we know when to stop for each of the plants. So this is kind of some of the stuff I talked to you about what this represents. That's what I'm talking about right there. That's the difference. You gotta get rid of the weeds. So many times people let the weeds grow instead of eliminating before you start and keeping them down. Now, I discovered something called E&O weeding. And people would come to the zoo garden, they see this beautiful big garden with no weeds. How do you do it? I said, E&O weeding. Early and often. That's the secret. Get those weeds before they get big and strong. The cultural practices that constitute the Midwinter system of growing go a long way toward reducing the risk of weed seeds, of bugs, and of diseases. For example, what you see there is bare, dry aisles and a dry perimeter. What we're doing is we're making the bugs cross the Sahara Desert to get to lunch. And we have a lot less trouble with them. A lot less problem with diseases because everything is dry except for roots on other plants. Think that makes a difference? You bet it does. Okay, very quickly. You've got to handle the competition. While may not become a loft type growth, certainly it's essential for success in gardening, don't you? You folks probably all have deer coming out into your yards, don't you? And you've probably got gophers. Yeah. I've been there, done that. They came into my garden at the local zoo as well. One of the nice things about this system of growing is that the healthy, fast-growing plants really resist disease because they are in the garden a shorter time. They're growing faster. Because they're healthy, they resist disease, just like humans. This is resist disease when we're healthy. So this is some of the ways why this system is so effective. Now, as I said, the dry periphery aisles really help a lot. One of the things that this gentleman neglected was proper pruning of those tomato plants. And that can be a real hazard for disease, because when it gets dark and moist and those kinds of things, plant is less healthy, and diseases can get started. So we want to avoid that at all possible. We also like to keep our leaves off the ground. You see, we'll take just any of those leaves that are touching the ground, we'll remove those, and that can help with that. If you folks will follow this recipe for a great garden, I know that you can have 5 to 10 times the yield that you have ever seen before. Just growing vertically by itself can increase your yields 3 to 5 times. Why? Because you've eliminated the diseases, or at least greatly reduced their incidence. You have eliminated the bugs and the foot traffic. You've given your plants much more light. You see one plant goes to the left, the next plant goes to the right. That is one of the systems and procedures that we borrowed from hydroponic growers. And that is why I can say you'll grow between 3 and 5 times as much just by going vertically using T frames. The thing I neglected to show you from that first picture was that thing right there is called an in the garden greenhouse. Works great around here to extend your growing season. Doesn't cost much, but by putting those two beds together, covering them, putting them in plastic, you can actually grow your seedlings in there. So you just put a little table and another piece of plastic, and they'll have full sun all day long. It takes virtually no heat, even in cold weather, to grow your seedlings right out in your garden in that kind of an apparatus. Recommended. We have schedules that we have to give out at our seminars. We were not prepared to bring them tonight. I sure wish I'd given them to all of you, because these are really great. This is a 3-page schedule that will teach you how to grow vertically. Also, something called the Garden Planting Detail Schedule. This thing is priceless. As a matter of fact, it costs nothing. But it will give you 14 different elements of information for every plant in your garden. We have those out, and we invite you all to get them. They're also available on our website and in our gardening groups. Another thing, you ever worry about deficiency symptoms? We give you a schedule that's about 10 pages long that'll tell you the predominant deficiency symptoms in all your plants. There is so much information that I can give you folks. As I mentioned, I teach this for months and months in college classes, and we try to do a half-day seminar and pour as much into people as we can. We've given you a glimpse of it tonight. I hope it's been helpful. If I have 30 seconds, maybe we got a question, or maybe there would be too many.
How do you know when you've reached your optimal amount of fertilizer on your plants? You don't over-fertilize.
The question is, how do you know, make sure you're not over-fertilizing? That's a great question. Dr. Medlayer figured it out for basically all of the plants. We stop feeding 3 weeks before maturity or 8 weeks before frost. 8 weeks before frost for a, ever-bearing plant, and 3 weeks before maturity for a single crop variety. So no matter what size plant you're growing, you always feed the same amount in the given space, but the plants are closer together, so that makes up the difference. It is a simple, foolproof system. Okay, the question is, how do you get the nutrients? And you know, all over the world, when Jacob would be there, he would teach people how to make those fertilizers, how to create them, and how to use them. The problem was that if he left, sometimes the people didn't know how to get find the fertilizers themselves, and that happened here in Utah. Once he moved away, it became difficult for people to get the fertilizers, and so the system, the method kind of died down because they couldn't find the, those magic minerals. What we've done is we have produced a little package called the micronutrient packet, and that has the 7 micronutrients in it, and it comes with instructions as to how you can make the weekly feed. And everything else is easily available at your local stores.
So you get that online?
Yeah, it's available online. You know, the stores around the world don't really want to carry that because one fertilizer replaces like 20 different fertilizers. Because every plant in your garden, every plant in your yard will love that fertilizer. I'm including trees, shrubs, berries, lawn, flowers, vegetables, isn't it? I didn't explain that very well. My year-round greenhouse, it had those black tubes. There's something called earth temperature. Geothermal means earth heat. The ground 6 feet under is 55 degrees year-round. And so if you put those pipes down there, and you put a simple blower on the end of those pipes, and you're moving 55 degree heat. You might start with 90 degree heat at the top in the summer, and you put it in a mirror and it circulates and it comes back out at 55 degrees. You're cooling your greenhouse in the summer. In the winter, you're putting 0 degree temperature in the ground, goes back and forth, comes up 55 degrees. My greenhouse in Missouri, we had 17 degrees below zero one day, with a 34 degrees minus windshield factor, right outside of my greenhouse. The greenhouse itself had no heat in it. It only had a blower, just a fan blowing air through those tubes. It was 36 degrees in my greenhouse. I put heat in it, as you saw from, I was going to show you more pictures if I had time. I've got some pictures of it. We put a little propane heater in it, and the day we did that, it was some 5 degrees, I think, outside with a minus 3 or something windshield. 40 degrees in the greenhouse before the heat, turn on the propane at the lowest setting, and in 10 minutes, it was 60 degrees in the greenhouse. And now I've got 11 citrus trees in my greenhouse, and greens like crazy, everything's growing. So, believe me, that would be fun for some of you folks here, I know, because it sure is fun for me.
Hey, thank you so much for coming. As usual, thanks for everyone helping us tear the chairs down, and thanks for being here, Jim.
Glad to be here.